Hey guys, and welcome back to my channel for another midweek mystery video. Today we're going to be talking about the case of Peter Bergman. Now this is another of the John Doe cases that I really love to do. People found dead under very mysterious circumstances and the authorities have never been able to ID them. These videos never seem to do as well on my channel for some reason, but they are my favourite to research and my favourite film. I just find them so interesting. Similar cases to this one, if you end up liking this video, I've done the Somerton Man, Tamam Shud, I've done Estelle Woman and Jennifer Fergate. I'll link them all down below if you want to go watch those after this one. Yeah, let's get into it. So the Peter Bergman case surrounds the mystery of a man who was found washed up on a beach called Ross's Point in Ireland. As of the day I'm filming this, so Monday the 29th of January 2018, he has remained unidentified for 8 years, 7 months and 10 days. After this body was found on the beach, the police obviously began their investigation and they found this man had checked into a hotel in Sligo in Ireland under the name Peter Bergman. And after even more research, they found that Peter Bergman didn't even exist. This man had given a fake name. Let's start from the very beginning with this case. So this was in 2009, so there was a lot of CCTV. And the first thing the police did when they found this unidentified man washed up on the beach is they pulled CCTV from across the entire town of Sligo. Can you imagine the man hours that went into an operation like that? So many man hours spent just watching the CCTV to find this man acting very, very strangely. So the first he is spotted on CCTV is the day it is thought he arrived in Ireland, or he could have been in Ireland beforehand, but this is the first time that he was taken notice of. It originally captures him at Ulster bus station in another town in Ireland called Derry. Of course, police went to Ulster bus station and started to interview people in the area, and they spoke to a bus driver. The bus driver said that this man came up to speak to him and asked him the best way to get to Sligo. And the bus driver directed him to a bus called the Galway Express, which would stop in Sligo on the way. The bus driver said that the man had a heavy Eastern European accent, and his description of him matched the other descriptions that had been given of this man. He was in his late 50s or 60s, he had short grey hair and stood at about 5'10". He was very, very slim as well, quite a thin build. He had blue eyes and appeared to be well dressed at all times. He wasn't sloppy, he seemed to take pride in his appearance and how he dressed. He was often seen in a black leather jacket and blue smart trousers. And so the next move that Peter made was he got on the bus to Sligo. Now Sligo is a town in the west of Ireland. It is not a massive town, it's a coastal seaport, and according to the Wikipedia page, it has a population of about 20,000. So it's not a massive, massive place. However, it is the second largest urban population in the west of Ireland. Now, Sligo is also a very popular tourist destination, which I found strange when I was researching it, because I've actually never heard of this town before. But apparently it's actually a very popular tourist destination for a lot of people in Germany. It's got a really rich history, it's by the sea. Apparently it's just quite a nice place to go and visit. CCTV footage showed Peter arriving at Sligo station at 6:28 PM on June 12th, 2009. A taxi driver picked him up and at Peter's request took him to Sligo City Hotel. This hotel was about a block away from the water and is not the most expensive hotel. It would have cost him €65 a night to stay there. He paid for the entirety of his stay in cash, and this is where things get a little bit weird and start to like match up with the other strange John and Jane Doe cases I talk about on this channel. So he has checked into this hotel, and as far as I can tell, he was not asked to show an ID, which showing an ID at a hotel when you check in is just standard practice. Passport, driver's license, even a credit card for them to hold. That's just what hotels do. And the fact that Peter Bergman has chosen to go to this hotel and check in and they haven't asked for ID shows that he's probably done his research as to where he wants to stay. So this is where he checked in as Peter Bergman, and although this isn't his real name, that's what we're going to refer to him as in this video because there's no other name that we know of to refer to him as. I'm not sure how much relevant the name Peter Bergman has. There's a few obituaries of people called Peter Bergman that died close to this time, but I feel like it's probably quite a common name. Maybe he chose it because it is more common and it's nothing that people would question, or maybe it's just a completely random choice. He also gave the hotel an Austrian address. I'm not even going to try and pronounce this address, I'm really sorry, I just don't want to completely butcher it. So I'm just going to put it up on the screen here so you can read that there. On further investigation, the police discovered that the address that Bergman had given to the hotel receptionist was actually the address of a completely vacant lot in Austria. Nobody lived there, it wasn't a house, it was just a vacant place. The hotel receptionist said that he arrived with one dark luggage bag and he spoke with a heavy German accent. So Peter was in the hotel from June 12th, 2009 to June 15th, which is when he checked out. And throughout this short stay, he left the hotel multiple times. Each time he left the hotel, he would have a purple plastic carrier bag with him. And when he left the hotel, it would appear to be about three quarters to completely full. And nobody knows what this purple bag was full of, but the police think that it was full of his personal items that he was getting rid of, because he would then return to the hotel hours later with no bag in sight. Obviously, he still had the purple carrier bag on him because he'd reappear later with the same bag, but he'd fold it up and put it in a pocket or something. However, bearing in mind that the majority of his stay is captured on CCTV, no CCTV in the entire city or entire town shows Bergman ever emptying this bag or discarding of the items. There's nothing, nobody knows what he did with these things. I mean, it's possible that he just threw them in a bag or threw them over a wall or maybe into the water, but it's just very weird that most of his trip is captured on CCTV, but not once is he caught getting rid of these items, which could provide some very valuable clues as to who he was. So Saturday, June 13th, 2009, the day after he checked in, he goes to a local post office, the General Post Office. In this post office, he purchases 8 82-cent stamps. Now, I'm not sure if he chose 8 stamps as a very specific number or if he just bought a book of 8 stamps. I mean, he also purchased some airmail stickers. So from this, you can deduce that he was writing letters to people, and it was most likely overseas because of the airmail stickers. Now, he could have written anywhere between 1 and 8 letters. But this leads me to think that there are people out there that know who this man was. The fact that he was sending letters shows that people were there to receive them. So it's just even more strange that nobody's ever come forward. And yet another strange thing happens the next day on Saturday, June the 14th. He approaches a taxi driver and asks the taxi driver, where's a nice beach that he can go and swim in the area? And the taxi driver recommends Ross's Point. Those lights have come down like 5 times now and they're driving me insane. A little side note here is that Peter Bergman actually told the taxi driver that he was from Austria. So Peter gets into the taxi driver's car and they drive to Ross's Point. Now, I've seen a couple of conflicting sources on this, but what I think happened here is that they drive to Ross's Point, Peter Bergman gets out of the car, looks around very briefly, and then gets back into the car. The taxi driver turns around and drops him back in Sligo. The taxi driver also said that whilst he was at Ross's Point, he pointed out to Peter the nearest bus stop. So Monday the 15th of June, Peter Bergman requests a late checkout from Sligo City Hotel and eventually comes down at 1:06 p.m. to hand in his key. He hands in his room key and leaves with a black shoulder bag, the purple plastic bag, which has made many appearances over his trip, and a black luggage bag, although the black luggage bag that he left with is different to the black luggage bag that he arrived with. So from here, he heads towards the bus station. On his way to the bus station, he stops at Quayside Shopping Centre and really awkwardly stands in a doorway for a few minutes. At 1:38 p.m, he arrives at the bus station and walks towards a food counter in the station. He orders a cappuccino and a ham and cheese toastie, and he sits down at a table. Now, a lot of the reports said that he sat down on his own, but the CCTV footage shows him at that time actually sat with somebody else. Although they're not talking, the other person's reading a newspaper. At this point, however, one of his black bags that he was carrying is gone. He's now only got 2 bags on him, and no CCTV shows him getting rid of this bag. While he was sat down at this table eating, he keeps pulling pieces of paper out of his pocket, and he keeps looking at these pieces of paper and then folding them up, putting them back. Then he gets them out again, looks at it, folds it up, puts it back. At one point, it actually shows him ripping up one of the pieces and just discarding of it. At 2:20 p.m, he boards a bus to Ross's Point. Now, there are 16 recorded sightings of him on the beach that day. People said that he was just wading in the water, he'd rolled up his trousers to around his ankles, and he was just like ankle deep in the water. Few people said that he waved and smiled at them. A lot of people said that he just looked like he was wandering aimlessly deep in thought. The following morning, on Tuesday the 16th of June, there are 2 people on the beach training for a triathlon they're doing, and at 6:45 a.m, they come across the washed up body of Peter Bergman. Of course, the police are contacted, and this is where they start their investigation. The first thing they did was search the beach, and within about 300 metres of his body, they found all of the following items, which I'm going to read off my notebook. So they found shoes, socks, trousers, a jumper, a black leather jacket, a pack of tissues, a sum of cash, although I don't think it was much cash, blank paper, plasters, aspirin tablets, watch and soap from the Sligo City Hotel. Once again, as in many of the other John and Jane Doe cases I've spoken about on this channel, most of the labels were cut out of his clothes. Not all of them, but most of them. Now, the clothes that his labels were cut out of were clothes that were sort of tend to be touching his skin, so shirts, underwear, things like that, which makes me think that he's probably just cut them out for comfort reasons, not to hide where he's got them from. Could not be, could be because it's all mysterious and weird, but I think it makes sense. He's probably cut them out so they don't irritate his skin. Police determined that most of his clothes were from a store called C&A, which is a popular retail fashion store mostly found in Germany and Austria, although it is in other places across Europe as well. Now, a lot of sources say that Peter Bergman's body was found completely naked. However, I have read sources as well that said that he was dressed or partially dressed when he was found. I'm more inclined to believe that he was partially dressed when he was found. The only reason I'm more inclined to believe that is because the description of what he was wearing when he was found is quite detailed, and I feel like nobody would make that up for no reason. So apparently he was found in a navy t-shirt tucked into swimming trunks, of which I think was Speedos actually, and he was wearing black underpants over his swimming togs, it says, which I guess he was wearing black underpants over his Speedos. The medical examiner confirmed that the cause of death was drowning. Again, sources on this are a little bit weird. Apparently there's one source that a lot of people were quoting saying that he didn't die from drowning because there was no sign of saltwater drowning on his body. However, when I went to find this article that stated this, had been taken down. So I'm not sure on that. But I'm pretty sure his cause of death was drowning. I think the confusion comes from on his autopsy. It says that there's no external signs of saltwater drowning. However, that doesn't mean because there's no external signs of it, it doesn't mean that isn't what happened. An important thing, however, is there are absolutely no signs of foul play on his body. His teeth were in very good condition. It's quite clear that he had had a lot of dental work over the years. However, apart from his dental work, it was actually very clear that this man was in incredibly poor health. He was in the advanced stages of prostate cancer, and his entire body was just riddled with bone tumours. His heart showed signs of previous heart attacks, and I did see something that stated that he only had one kidney, but that also wasn't mentioned in any of the medical reports that I read on this case. So I feel like he possibly did have both of his kidneys, and one of the sources I read got that wrong, but I wanted to mention it anyway. However, even though he had advanced cancer, was covered in tumours, and his heart was in poor condition, he had no medication in his system at all. He would have been in so much pain. A lot of the CCTV footage that showed Bergman in the area in the days before his death as well showed that he was a heavy, heavy smoker. He constantly had a cigarette in his mouth. There was a 5-month investigation into who this guy was, and it sort of amounted to nothing. They never found out, and he was buried 5 months later in Sligo. In 2015, about 6 years after he was found dead, a French newspaper called Le Monde contacted Austrian authorities about the Peter Bergman case. The Austrian police actually replied saying that the Irish police had never contacted them about this case. Le Monde also reported that there is no Interpol notice for this missing man. Interpol, if you don't know, is sort of the missing persons database in very basic terms. But however, because his body was recovered, he doesn't count as a missing person or a wanted person, so he probably wouldn't be on Interpol anyway. He's just completely unidentified. But it would have been up to Bergman's country of origin to report him as missing, and they never have. Assuming, due to many factors in this case, that the country of origin is either Germany or Austria. As for theories in this case, I really don't have much. I think it is quite obvious here that Bergman probably chose to die on his own terms. He was in Ireland to die because he was in such advanced stages of cancer. I think that is pretty obvious. If it isn't that, then that is a whole other story. I think the weird thing in this case is, why did he feel the need to come to Ireland to do so? He clearly had loved ones that he was sending letters to, or if he wasn't sending letters to his loved ones, then he was sending letters to maybe a lawyer or someone like that, who have kept up their pact of confidentiality in this case. But the fact that he sent letters makes it clear that there are people out there who know who he is, but nobody's ever come forward. Maybe his family are just completely respecting his wishes for him to go down in history as an unidentified man, but why would they? Why would he want to go down as unidentified? Why would he want to travel so far away to die if he did have family at home? I know it is a choice that some people make to do that, but surely the family would come forward and say, oh yes, this was my husband, my dad, my son, my uncle, someone like that. It is so clear that everything that Bergman did was pre-planned. He chose a hotel that he knew wouldn't ask for ID. He knew where he was going. He planned to go to Ross's Beach the day beforehand. Even the address he gave was for a vacant lot. He had planned everything. I'm inclined to believe that he is from the area where the address he gave was from, because how else would he have known that that was a vacant lot? Otherwise, that would have been a lot of research and it could have gone wrong. I think he must have been from the area to know that lot was vacant. I think that Bergman wanted to choose a beach to go and die on because he thought the tide would take him out to sea and his body would never be found. However, the tide actually brought his body back in, and therefore there's been this whole investigation into who he was, whereas I don't think he ever wanted any of this. I think he just wanted to disappear. I think the strangest thing in this case though is, where did all his belongings go? What did he do with them? He was clearly trying to get rid of personal effects before his suicide. How he was so careful about it, he made sure there was no CCTV around him when he was doing this, is just, it's so much effort to go to. Another thing that I find very weird is this man is clearly like trying to stay like unknown. He doesn't want people to know who he is. Yet he's wandering around town with this bright purple carrier bag, which is clearly going to draw attention to him and people are going to remember that. There's a definite potential that this could have been an insurance scam. Maybe he wanted to get some money for his family, which is why his family have never come forward. Let's say he is from Austria. Now, I'm not claiming to know how insurance across Europe works, but I'm just going to talk about this. If I'm completely wrong, you can tell me. But let's say he's from Austria. He knows he's ill. He doesn't tell his insurance that he's ill. Or I'm sure they would probably get records from doctors anyway, but I'm going to continue with this train of thought. He doesn't tell the insurance he's ill and his family need money, so he decides to just disappear. So his family mark him down as a missing person, and after a certain amount of years, he's declared dead and his family get an insurance payout. Maybe I've got some details wrong, maybe there's more intricacies to it than that, but I do think that is a possibility in this case. And that's where I'm going to end this video. I really like these cases because there's so many possibilities, but this one is particularly weird because I think it's quite obvious he chose to end his life on his own terms. The question is, why did he go to such extreme lengths to do so? Let me know down below all of your theories. I'd love to hear them. Make sure you like this video and subscribe to my channel, and I will see you in my next one. Bye guys.